Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for coming by to our event. We have a very special speaker today. This is Mike DeLucia, who wrote a book, Madness, on Hank Luisetti, one of the best basketball, arguably the best basketball player. I'll let Mike get
Tell
into
you
that.
Why.
Yeah. So without further ado, thank you so much for coming by. And I'm going to pass it over to Mike to talk a little bit about his book, his story, and share with you all a little bit of Stanford history today.
All right, well, you're welcome. Thank you. And I am so happy to be here. This is like a bucket list thing for me because I've been had Stanford University and I've had Hank Luisetti on my mind for the past 35 or 36 years because that's when I started this. So I want to thank you, Alejandro, for reaching out and for arranging all of this. I really, really appreciate it. Yeah, it started around 1983 when I first got the idea, but it probably started when I was in the eighth grade. Prior to that, I was a big sports person. All the books that I've written so far have been in the sports genre. My next book that I'm gonna start this summer is also, it's a fictional book about baseball. But it was in the eighth grade where a teacher from my school put on a musical. And I went down and my friends were in it and I looked at it and I said, I wanna do that. So I was bitten by the acting bug, and from that point on, I mean, I still played sports, but not as much as I did acting. And I went to, when I graduated high school, I went to college for 1 year and then just left, and I went to acting school in Manhattan, because I come from the Bronx, and studied it. But I got married very young. I had kids very young. I started a business, and going down to auditions and trying to do all of that became impossible for me. So I said, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to be like Sylvester Stallone. I am going to write my own movie, and I'm going to star in it. I'm not going to sell it to anybody unless I'm in it, which sounds really funny right now. But when I was 23, it sounded like a rock-solid plan. So, but what to write about? I had never really written anything before. I'd written some things, but nothing substantial. And I wanted to write this movie that MGM was knocking on my door looking for me. So we're Italian, and on Sunday we have a big family dinner, and my wife and I went home, and this is my idea. I'm going to write a movie, and my father said, I have the perfect guy for you to write about, Hank Luisetti. And I said, who is Hank Luisetti? He's the greatest basketball player that ever lived. Went to Stanford University. He was the 20s or the 30s or something like that. He invented the layup. Which I was like, all right, it sounds pretty. And he says, no, it's a great story. I read this little paragraph about him in this book, and I never forgot it. So at the time, like I said, I was in my own business. So I literally took off 2 weeks from work. I hired somebody to run the business for me, and I took the train down to Manhattan. This was before the internet was born, and I was just looking through, microfilms, and I was really trying to find out the details of a ghost. No one knew who he was. None of the librarians, I had to look him up by name. I had to go, again, my father didn't know exactly when he played. He said the 20s or the 30s. And, so eventually I started to put together this little skeleton of a story. And there wasn't a lot of personal information about him. I was looking at, newspaper clippings, and I was, going through things like that. Later on, the periodicals, like stuff that came out in the 70s, I was able to locate a few things that gave me some information. So with the lack of information I had, I decided to make it historical fiction. So I would fill in the blanks. I would try and include all of the really phenomenal things that he did, and I would build a story around it. And there it started. The first version of this is actually handwritten. I still have it. And but it kept, with my life the way it was, and I didn't know anybody in the movie business, I would send things out, to people after I eventually typed it out. But I sat there with this, how to write a screenplay book, and all of this piles and piles of photocopies and all that sort of thing. And then I wrote it, but it kind of just, kept winding up on the end of my to-do list, and sometimes it stayed there for decades. But I never forgot, the story. I always wanted to get the story out there. I always thought it was a really good story. So I went back to school later on. I'm a teacher now. I teach English. And I took a film writing class there, and I kind of polished, the version. said, this is a really good story, but you're lacking a love interest. You know, it was like really just like boys in basketball. You know, there was no real, and they said, you've got to put in, you know, he's got to have a love interest. So I created this, you know, character of Connie. You know, I made that his, you know, his and I built the story around that. And again, they're the virgin sack for a while. I would send out, you know, things to people, and a couple of people were interested. HBO was actually interested at one time, because I'm Italian-American. Hank Luisetti is Italian-American. And so some of my, I was reaching out to Italian-American organizations like Sons of Italy and, you know, Knights of Columbus, you know, National. And one, they were battling HBO because of The Sopranos, and they said, you know what, you know, you're only depicting the Italians as gangsters. You know, you need to show the Italians in a different light. And they presented this story, and HBO really liked it. But they said, yeah, we'd like to see it. At that time, I don't think HBO made their own movies, and I didn't have, you know, just a guy who had a story. So that kind of fell by the wayside. And you might remember the boxer Ray Boom Boom Mancini. He was interested in it for a while. He wanted to make a documentary out of it. It was funny. He was a champion. He was really big in the 80s, and, you know, unfortunately, actually, you know, killed somebody in the ring. You know, and that was sort of like the end of his career after that. Mentally, he couldn't, you know, deal with it. His, like, career really kind of took a nosedive after that. But it was funny. I researched him a little bit, and I was on vacation one day, and my phone rings, and like, you know, I was like, this is Ray Boom Boom Mancini. Like, really? So he called me up. We had a couple of conversations about it, and again, it sort of just faded away. You know, that's the way the movie business is. So that's the story until finally I wrote a book about the Yankees. That was my first book. And then after that book, I wrote a short story called Settling the Score. And then I was going to write this baseball movie that I'm going to write now, or it's going to be actually a fiction novel first. And then I said, you know what? Before that, I need to get the story out there. I need to get the story out there. So I was going to put it out in film form. You know, dialogue. And then I decided, you know what, I'm going to turn it into a novel. So so here it is. So finally it came out, and actually, you know, I was contacted by a director and a producer recently, and he's interested in the film. I also have another guy who I ran into, and he is really, he loved the book, and he said he has a friend of his. He did a documentary, and he raised $5 million to get this documentary made, and he's putting me in touch with the man with the money. And so, you know, that's kind of like a little bit in the works too. So I'm getting more and more, you know, kind of excited at the fact that this may be actually the movie that I wanted it to be. I'm a little old to play Hank right now, but that's okay. So what's the book about? Why is it such a great story? Why'd I hang on to it for 35 years? Because Hank Luisetti is the greatest basketball player that ever lived. And when I say that to people, they're often like, yeah, all right, come on. Yeah. Michael Jordan would smoke him. I mean, this guy, we don't even know who he is. Here's my argument. You cannot put people from different eras against and compare them to people in other eras. It's an impossible thing to do. You can't say who's best unless they played in the same era against similar teams, and they themselves were on championship teams where they were able to really, you know, put, and then you can compare. Then you can say, okay, well, this person was better than that person. But you can't take somebody from the 1980s or 90s when Jordan played, because he is considered to be the greatest by, you know, most Google searches, against somebody who played in the 30s. But let me tell you why. Here's my argument. We need to put together what they did against their contemporaries. So, was Michael Jordan the most famous basketball player of his era? Without a doubt, he was. Was Hank Luisetti? Yes, he was. He was the first national celebrity basketball player in the country. Did Michael Jordan lead his team to championships? Yes, he did. Did Hank Luisetti? Yes, he did. If you go over to the pavilion, you'll see they won the 3 years that he played. As a freshman, their freshman team went undefeated. Sophomore, junior, senior year, they won. Was Michael Jordan innovative? Yes, he was. Was Hank Luisetti? Even more so. And I'll tell you why in a little bit. They say that Michael Jordan could, you know, they call him Air Jordan. The people who saw Luisetti play said that he could stay in the air so long, he literally defied gravity. What else can we say about the two of them? I think I've pretty much hit. Did they both score records? Did they both set records? Yes, they did. Scoring records. In fact, Michael Jordan has the most points of anyone else. Hank Luisetti set scoring records every single year he played. Freshman, sophomore, junior, senior year. And when he left, he was the highest scoring basketball player. He was the first person to score 50 points in one game. And that might not sound like so much to you, because basketball is a changed game now. Back then, total scores of basketball games were about 30 points. He scored 50 points in one game by himself. The score was like 90-something to like 25. He was that good. Why is he better? Luisetti played in a time when total scores of basketball games were like 30 points, 35 points. It was like lacrosse today. It was a school sport. It was in the Olympics. But it was not a pro, they had no pro league. They didn't have a pro league because they didn't have a fan base. It was like a borrowed fan base from baseball and football season. Basketball wasn't that exciting. You'd shoot with two hands. You dribbled with one. You passed with two hands. You shot baskets at the foul line underhanded. And there was a center jump after each basket. It was man-to-man defense, and it was not that exciting. Luisetti popularized and perfected the running one-handed shot. There were some people doing it, but not like him. He was also ambidextrous. They say that he could put the ball in the hoop from anywhere on the court with either hand, sometimes without even looking. He was fast breaking at a time when people weren't even breaking. He was an expert dribbler. He was the first person to dribble behind his back. He led Stanford University. Before him, mostly Cal and Southern Cal would win the Western Division, championship. And with Luisetti came, I mean, they would won before that with him, started new championships started to come, and people were coming from all around just to see this one-handed wonder, play the game. But history changed in 1936 when this promoter from New York, his name was Ned Irish, he was starting to use the New York teams at Madison Square Garden and say, we have some pretty good teams. Let's get some people from across the country to start playing. This is the beginning of March Madness. Let's bring other teams into play at the Garden. LIU, at the time, was the greatest basketball team of all time. They had a 6'8" center, and when you had a center jump after each basket, a 6'8" center is going to get you a lot of tips. And they had won 43 games in a row. They were so good that the United States asked them to represent the United States in the 1936 Olympics. That's how good the team was. Like, that team wanted LIU to play the world in Berlin. But there were a lot of Jews on that team, and they did not like what they were hearing about what was going on in Germany. And they made a vote, and they decided, we're going to boycott. No, thank you, we're not going to play there. That's how good they were. I mean, to think about it, usually you take, here, this person, here, this person, there. They took that whole, they wanted to say, you guys represent us in the Olympics. So they thought that this was going to be an easy game. LIU thought that they were going to run all over this team from California. In fact, the year before, the person who, I think it was Cal, had won the championship out west, and they brought them in, and they folded at the Garden. And the Garden was 17,000. It held like almost 18,000 people. Compared to the Pavilion, it was a big difference. Stanford University came into Madison Square Garden and absolutely destroyed LIU. They had no answers for anything Luisetti was doing. They were so far out of their league that Madison Square Garden people started cheering Luisetti's baskets. Can you imagine, an outside team coming into, and then the fans of them, winners of 42 games in a row, cheering for the other team? They gave Luisetti a standing ovation when he left, and he was voted the most outstanding athlete to perform in Madison Square Garden in 1936. Pro teams, whoever played in Madison Square Garden, he was voted the number one guy. He was so famous that after he graduated from Stanford, he was signed to play himself in a movie with one of the hottest stars at the time, Betty Grable. They paid him $10,000 in 1938 to play himself in a movie. He grew up in the same neighborhood as Joe DiMaggio. They knew each other. Luckily, Joe DiMaggio had Major League Baseball, where he can just thrive. But after Luisetti graduated Stanford, there really wasn't much to do. There wasn't a pro team. But what happened was that game at Madison Square Garden, the New York reporters started talking about, if we want to compete, this is the way we have to play. And they would describe, because there was no TV, they would describe Luisetti. And people started to emulate Luisetti. People started to shoot with one hand. People started to drill behind their back. People started to do fast breaks. People wanted to be him. And all of a sudden, basketball got hot. Basketball got hot. There came a fan base. Right after Luisetti graduated, March Madness began. It was the year later. Graduated 38. March Madness began in 1939. With that came a fan base. With that came the NBA. Hank Luisetti is responsible for basketball the way we know it today. It was he who put the juice in basketball and made it a game that people wanted to go and see. Nobody, not even Air Jordan, can say that. Nobody can make that claim. He is responsible. I'm definitely going to write a letter to the president of the university. I want to let him know and say, you know what, here's the book. I think there should be more of a presence of Luisetti here. You know, there is a statue that we look for. It's an 8-foot statue, bronze statue of Luisetti that is under repair. It's in the book here. But, you know, he's been a hero of mine for a very long time. And, you know, again, like I said, it's a bucket list to come here to actually be. I mean, the favorite part for me when we went around and looked at the tour was to go to the old pavilion where he played. You know, and I said, okay, he was here. He was here. And it's great for me to see it. And that, you know, is what I have to say about this book and what it means to me. It is, it'll probably always be my favorite book. You know, even books that I haven't written yet, that I have outlines for, I don't think anything is going to actually ever have the impact that this had on me and my life and how much I enjoyed. You know, it originally started off called, it was called Hank Luisetti, The Hank Luisetti Story, and it changed a few times. But now it's just, you know, I decided no one knows who Hank Luisetti is. So I put the Hank Luisetti story on the cover. People know, like, yeah, well, who's that? So I think Madness is more appropriate for today because March Madness is such a big thing. You know, my students actually kind of convinced me to change the name. Not that they knew about it, but they were talking about, you know, like March Madness all the time. And I'm like, you know, you guys like March Madness? Yeah. And I'm like, oh, I know the guy who kind of started it. You know, and so that's how I came up with the new title. But anyway, if anyone is interested or has any questions about, you know, whether it's about writing, about the aspect of writing, you know, do we have any writers here? Any future book writers, perhaps? It's, you know, to actually write a book, you know, to have a full-time job and to write a book, you know, people say, well, you know, well, how do you do it? And it is absolute and total dedication and choices. You have to decide. I get up every day at 3:45 and I do work before work. When I'm done with work, or even if, you know, I have lists of things to do before I go to bed at night, I write down what I need to do the next day. I have a bigger list to say, okay, what do I want to accomplish here? And then I have my daily list. What do I want to get done tomorrow? What do I have to do? Even, you know, in summer, you know, school days, snow days, days off, Christmas Day, any day. I don't watch TV anymore. I just, except for Game of Thrones, that exception. Other than that, I don't watch TV. I don't even listen to the radio in the car anymore. You know, I think about what I'm going to do. I think about, you know, what I need to do to get this book out there. What do I have to do? How do I get it out to more people? So it is a, you know, it's a constant, you know, and it's sacrifice. You know, it's my family, it's my friends, it's my job, and it's my writing. And that's it. That's what becomes most important thing. So, you know, I try to get 6 hours of sleep at night. Doesn't always happen, but that alarm rings at 3:45, and I do not ever hit snooze. It's just I do not stop. This is it. So. Thank you so much.
So I definitely wanted to open up for questions. I have a couple of my own, but we can get started if anybody has any questions specifically about the book, or a question about Hank Luisetti, basketball related, writing related. I'm sure Mike is open to that as well.
What did Hank do besides making the movie? What did Hank do with the rest of his life?
Good question. Hank Luisetti got injured. He almost died in World War II. He got spiral meningitis, which was fatal. And they had just come up with these wonder drugs, these sulfur drugs. He was in a coma for 2 weeks, actually. When he came out of the coma, I think he had gone down to 100 pounds or 90-something pounds. He was near death. But they told him that, you know, his heart was damaged and that he would never be able to play, you know, like competitive basketball, you know, anymore. It would be too dangerous for him. So when the NBA formed, you know, you would never guess which team was coming pounding on his door, and kind of like came back to him several times asking to play for them, the New York Knicks. Because when he played at Madison Square Garden, and he went back, it wasn't a fluke, he went back there the following year and they beat them again. He beat LIU and CCNY on consecutive nights. They came to the East and they just beat everybody. They were the first, you know, unofficial national champions, Stanford University. So he took his Stanford diploma, and he had a career after that. And he did coach, you know, he coached. And when he was in the Navy, they say that he was, you know, the people who saw him play when he was in the Navy, he led the Navy team to another championship season. Wherever he played, they won. I think at one point, you know, I forget the exact numbers, but it was a division game. It was like they decided who was going to win the conference title. And they were down by something like 30 points in the fourth quarter. And he scored 32 points in 32 minutes, something along that. I forget the exact numbers to beat the next team. When they had to win, he just got another level. He just, you know, he was knocked out on the court. And instead of going, he was like, no, stitch me in the locker room. You know, I'm going back out. You know, he was, you know, but anyway, unfortunately, we never got to see him in the NBA. He turned down, you know, the offers to play. He would have been the best. He would have been the best player in the NBA without a doubt, because he was the best player, and that was kind of like his era. So yeah, unfortunately, you know, it happened that way. But he was in the very first. He is in the Hall of Fame. He's in the Basketball Hall of Fame. He was in the first group of people when they started the Hall of Fame. Somebody, his daughter, and I saw it in a review. His daughter said he was the first person inducted into the Hall of Fame. But I looked, you know, for that, and I couldn't, you know, I can't substantiate it. But I know he was in the first class, the very first group of people went into that, which is a pretty big honor when you think about it, because he never played in the NBA. But yet he is, and he won All-American all years he played. He won College Player of the Year. All-American, now those days, All-American, they only chose one player for each position. So they only chose one forward, and he won every year he played. They say he was the most incredible player to watch. You know, to put him against the teams of his time, it was like taking a modern-day basketball player and throwing him in the middle of a prehistoric, you know, game. They couldn't stop him. So. Any other? Yeah.
Were there any pushback from other players or referees or people like that at the time saying, like, this is not how you play basketball?
Yes. In fact, he had a battle. You know, the people were saying that's not real basketball. They really tried to squish it, especially in New York. One of the most famous coaches at the time, Nat Holman for CCNY, there's a quote in the newspaper. He said, I'll quit basketball if I have to teach one-handed shots to win. So he had to overcome a lot of adversity, because when you're the first person to do something, there's always going to be pushback from traditionalists. People will say, you know, that's not real. It's not the way it's supposed to be done. So he had to battle. He had to battle the establishment, really, to say, no, this is the way to play. So it switched from a defense game to an offense game. offense game, you know, because of him. Before it was like really defense based. So that was a good question. I forgot to mention it.
I know you mentioned his sister. What's it, his daughter?
Oh, did I say sister? I meant daughter.
Okay.
Sorry.
You might have said daughter, but
I
was just wondering, in general, what kinds of people did you talk to get information about him? You talked to teammates, fans, about basketball historians in this period?
I never talked to his family. I never, was able to get information from other people, which is why I went with, now with the internet, it's so much easier. Plus, as he got older, he did sit down with somebody. There is a book out there called, what's the name of it? I forget the name of it right now, but there is and he sat down for interviews in his later years. So I was able to get some information, but this was already written. So I didn't go back and change anything. It's historical fiction. What I did was I would say it's like a 65-35 mix, 35 being actual. All the things he did, though, like, that's in here. Like, 50 points in one game is in here. Scoring the points that he did, the way he did it, all that is true. And I also have, John Bunn was the coach here. He was the coach, so that sort of stuff I have. All the players that played with him, they're all in the book. And so I made up their personalities based on the very little that I knew about them. So, but I didn't actually talk, because again, it's historical fiction. You know, it's not a biography or anything like that, or a documentary. Game Changer, that's the name of the book by Phil. Anyone else? Those are all good questions. Thank you, really. Yes?
Do you know much about his life before coming to Stanford?
A lot of the information about his life I got from the book, Game Changer, that I didn't know when I was, writing the book. Because back then, again, I was working on newspapers and a couple of Time magazine, articles that I read later on about him in the 70s. He played in the 30s. These came out, 40 years later. So I was able to kind of put together. He was a very private person. He that you get right off the bat from anything that you read about him. He was, if you know anything about Joe DiMaggio, he was very similar. Joe DiMaggio did not like the limelight. Luisetti loved the game. He didn't like the fame. He was a very private person. In fact, in that game, we scored the 50 points. He called a timeout in the middle of the game. And he got the players and he said, "What are you guys doing?" He said, "Why are you feeding me so much?" Because they had all gotten together and they just said, "Let's just keep feeding him. Let's see how many points he could actually put together if we just keep feeding him the ball." So he said, "This is a team sport. Now let's play this game the way it's supposed to be played." And I cut it out. So they went out there. First person got the ball, tossed it back to me. Tossed it to them. They tossed it back to him. So it just like no one listened to him. And that's how he did it. He was, he was really into the game, every aspect of the game, and it was actually his coach here, John Bunn, that turned him into a shooter. He had all, the goods with him when he was at Galileo High School, but he averaged 5 points a game. He considered himself a playmaker. Like, he didn't want to be the guy, like, the star of the team. He wanted to set other people up so that they look good. That was like his, he shunned, like I say, he loved the game, he did not like the fame. So, anything I read about him really came later on when he got older and he started to talk about his life, which people, might do as they get on in years. So, any others?
I have a question. What was it like writing a book on somebody that is like unknown or just there's very little information out there about him?
The
challenges?
It was those 2 weeks that I went to the library every day and like I said, I was researching a ghost. No one knew who he was. Even to this day, I tell people, because really up until, the book Game Changer, I'm not sure what kind of, it's like an 800-page book, or I forget, it's a really, really long book. I couldn't believe how many pages actually, they go into a lot of detail about, the old style of basketball and all. But it was just fun kind of discovering, it's like you're on this journey. And every little bit of information, like you're mining it, like, oh wow, that's really cool, that's, so it was interesting actually, instead of, writing writing about somebody who there's a lot of information about him out there. This was kind of cool, you know, digging around, you know, gathering this information, you know, about and putting it all together in a book. So.
Yeah. And so now with the book out, I mean, what's sort of the next step forward? What can we see from you? What is like sort of the next phase of your life sort of look like?
Well, my two main goals that are, you know, written in big letters on my wall, like so a couple of minor things, is number one is to get this made into a movie. So whenever I talk to people and I do book talks, the first thing, that's how I got pretty much all the movie, you know, feedback that I'm getting from people now. It's all from going out and talking to people and, hey, I want to make this into a movie. This would be a great movie. You know, just think about this if it were, you know, on cable during March Madness, you know, or, you know, beginnings of it all and so on and so forth. And number two, I want to get into schools. My goal is to get into 1% of the schools in this country. If I can get on summer reading lists, I can get on outside reading lists in high schools. That's my next goal because I want this to go mainstream. I want people to know who he was and what he did. And if you read the book, you know, you'll see it's pretty exciting. So those are my two main goals with it.
I know that when we had talked, you mentioned a little bit about, like, you know, Hank being Italian, yourself being an Italian-American. How do you see sort of that cultural connection coming into play in your writing, or how was that an impactful force?
You know, it helped me write the book, because when I was talking about Hank Luisetti at home, I knew all that stuff, so I could just fill in the blanks. Like, there's a lot about food in here. You know, we talk about Hank Luisetti and his family on Christmas Eve. For Italians, Christmas Eve is the big event. It's the night of the fishes, and we just eat, you know, fish. It's a big tradition, and so I include, you know, a Christmas Eve dinner, you know, there. And his father actually owned a restaurant, so I talk a little bit about, you know, about that and so on and so forth. So that I could really, you know, sort of fit in, and I sort of molded his parents around my grandparents. You know, I thought about how they were, because they were around the same age. So I was able to really kind of fill in all those blanks. But, you know, another reason for me, you know, personally as an Italian-American, is I'm also on this mission about how Italians are portrayed in the media. You know, we're either murderers or we're uneducated, F-bomb-dropping goons for the most part. You know, that's pretty much the way Italians are portrayed. You know, I challenge anybody to tell me a movie from the 70s until now, except for Unbroken, that shows Italians in any ways other than that. That's really the way they are. I knew somebody who had a movie, or I forget what it might have been, a movie, and he went to a producer and he said, "Where's the gangsters?" And he said, "Well, there aren't any gangsters." He said, "No, no, I'm not interested. I only wanted gangsters." So, you know, Italians are a lot different than the stereotypes that are portrayed in the movies. And Italians are very, we've contributed in so many different areas of the world, and advancement in so many different ways, in science and, you know, math and inventions and in, you know, just about every area. So to kind of pigeonhole us into these two little things. So that's why, you know, here we have Luisetti, and none of that is in the book. There's no references to the mafia. There's no references to any of that sort of thing. He's educated quite, right? Went to Stanford University, and he contributed to a sport, and there's nothing about any of the stereotypes in this book. So so that holds a little bit of a strong presence for me as well. So,
I have one last question myself. So I know we have like a lot of sports writers in the room, writers in general. What's your sort of message to, like, us as like sort of the next generation that's covering Stanford in general, or you know, specifically to the sports writers that are covering, you know, what is like a very rich history of the school? You know, I'm sure that in writing this book there's a lot of reflection on, you know, Hank Luisetti, his life, and sort of like the honor that it is to like cover that, or you know, what role you play in telling that story.
Maybe, you know, maybe look at Stanford's history and start comparing it to, you know, the players of today. You know, all of your athletic, you know, this is a school rich in sports history. So I would say bring that stuff back. You know, I saw an article, a really interesting one. It had Luisetti and it had Stephen Curry. And it said, without him, would be him. And it was a really cool article, and it sort of brought, you know, the beginning of basketball up until what's happening now. And I thought it was a really interesting story. So maybe you guys can kind of mine some of that, you know, history from Stanford. And when you talk about players of today, maybe you can talk about or do some series on the history of Stanford's, you know, sports and, you know, what these great teams were like, and bring it back. And it could bring back, you know, a feeling for the people that go to Stanford that, you know what, yeah, it's not just about what we do now. You know, look at what we've done. We are, you know, we're an elite school. You know, we have a rich history in sports. So maybe bringing back a story a week about a great team or a great player, somebody who's changed and you know, made an impact on a sport. And I mean, just looking through the, you know, one step to the, what's the name of the place you went to today? The
Home of Champions.
You know, taking a look at some of that stuff and looking at these players and maybe talking about them and, you know, and bringing it out to the people that go to the school now. You know, I certainly want to see more about Luisetti. I was really disappointed. There is an 8-foot bronze statue of Luisetti that was made by one of his teammates, and unfortunately, it's being repaired right now. So, you know, stuff like that, you know, is really kind of cool. That place is really good, though. I'm sure you guys have gone there, the Home Champions, that was cool. Really cool. Really, you know, it shows you a lot of what Stanford, you know, has, you know, regarding sports. Who's sports writers here? Who are sport writers?
Hold on.
So much for having
so
me.
Much,
I'm doing book signing in case anybody's interested.
Yeah. He's gonna be signing some books, and you're more than welcome to sort of chat, hang around.